Ja, schönen guten Abend. Ich möchte Sie ganz herzlich begrüßen im Namen des Deutschen Filmmuseums und Filminstituts und des Afrika Live Festivals zu unserer 26. Ausgabe des Festivals. Und ich freue mich sehr, dass wir heute Abend wieder einen Gast hier haben, Mamadou Dia, den ich ganz, ganz herzlich begrüßen möchte. Ich werde ein paar Worte zu ihm sagen. Er ist aus dem Senegal, hat aber in New York an der Tisch School of the Arts und hat studiert und hat dort seinen Master of Fine Arts gemacht. Er hat unter anderem bei Spike Lee gelernt und hat dann schon vorher auch als Videojournalist gearbeitet und danach auch als Kameramann und er gibt Workshops. Hat zunächst ein paar Kurzfilme gemacht, ein paar dokumentarische Kurzfilme und dann den Film Kurzfilm Samedi Cinema von 2016, der damals in Venedig seine Premiere hatte. Ist ein Kurzfilm über zwei Jungen, die unbedingt noch in einem Kino im Senegal einen Film auf der großen Leinwand sehen wollen, bevor das Kino für immer seine Pforten schließt. Der Film ist sehr viel auf Festivals gelaufen. Wir haben ihn hier auch 2018 gezeigt. Und dann als nächstes hat er eben seinen ersten Langspielfilm gemacht, den wir heute Abend sehen, Bamum Nafi, Nafis Vater. Der Film hat seine Premiere im letzten Jahr auf dem Filmfestival in Locarno gehabt und hat dort gleich auch zwei Preise gewonnen. Einmal den Preis fürs Erstlingswerk und dann auch in der Sektion Cinema of the Present den Hauptpreis. Und er lief auch jetzt... Und er war jetzt auch gerade in Rotterdam auf dem Filmfestival und hat dort seinen Film präsentiert und jetzt bei uns. Für den Film hatte er unter anderem von dem Hubert-Balz-Fonds eine Unterstützung für das Drehbuch bekommen. Den Film selber hat er aber dann ganz unabhängig finanziert. Soweit vorweg. We will do the Q&A afterwards. We will do it in English. And I hope this is okay for you. Otherwise, if somebody needs translation, I will try a little bit to translate some words, some things in German. But yes, you have to tell us if you need a translation or not. Because the film is in... okay, then... okay, so we'll try to translate for you. No problem. So I don't want to say too much in front. Do you want to... say two words?
Yeah. Thank you so much for coming. Merci beaucoup à ceux qui sont venus voir le film. I don't speak German, but I trust you enough to applaud when you do. Thank you so much. So this is a film that is made in Senegal. It was entirely shot in my hometown in northern Senegal. It's called Matam. It's a very small town. It was a film made by with very little money and a lot of love. As she said, we only got the Hubert-Balz fund, and you're gonna see here only the two brothers, the two main actors are professional. Everyone else has never played in the movie. So I hope you're gonna love them as we did love them while we were shooting the film, and I wish you enjoy. Bonne projection. Thank you. Thank you.
It's a very strong film, and it's a lot of issues you point out in this film. I start with question, what was your starting point to develop the story? Ich habe gefragt nach seinem Ausgangspunkt, um diese Geschichte zu entwickeln, weil die aus sehr, sehr vielen Strängen und sehr vielen Erzählungen besteht und mich interessiert, was der Ausgangspunkt war.
Thank you so much, and thank you for those of you who stayed. If you want to stand up to stretch your legs, because it's been an hour and 45 minutes, you can take some seconds to do it. I don't mind. So I think this is an interesting question because this is my hometown. This is where I was born and I grew up. And in 2014, I went to New York to do a master in film. And then I realized every time I said I'm Muslim, I had to explain. I had to say, I'm Muslim, but in Senegal it's different. I'm Muslim, but in West Africa or in this part of Africa, that's not how we live Islam. And then this justification after a year or 2 years just took a toll on me. Why do I have to explain all the time, right? So the idea is to show Islam the way we live it, to show Islam the way we live it in a way that we mix it with our pre-Islamic religions and we mix it with many other practices. It's not what's defined us. When I say I'm Muslim, I'm not thinking that's the first definition of myself, of my being. I'm first a human being. I think like 9% of the Muslims we don't see on TV because they don't make that much noise are people like, you know, like you and I, who want to have better jobs, who want to have a beautiful car, who want to have a nice house. So that's what I wanted to show here, to see this is the biggest part of Muslims. That's what they want to live with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very short translate. Als in Amerika war, wurde immer wieder gefragt, was ihm das Muslimisch ausmacht. Und er versucht jetzt in diesem Film ein bisschen zu erklären, worum es ihm geht, dass es da sehr unterschiedliche Formen gibt, dass es eben auch in seiner Heimat, in seinem Heimatort sehr, sehr unterschiedliche Formen, dass es auch gemischt wird mit anderen, mit anderen mit den traditionellen Religionen dort. Genau. So your hometown was also inspiration for you for the stories you tell in the film.
Yes, so for those who know Senegal, they know that we didn't have any issue with religious extremism. So knocking on wood, that one that never happened. So this, I did it in my home city because I wanted it to be a community experience. This is the first movie that is shot in Matam. And also because, as I said in the beginning, we didn't have money. So I was writing like a producer. I knew all the houses, I knew all these people. I knew the only hotel in my region that has a swimming pool, that would be the mayor's house. I knew the mosque that has an imam that was cool enough to let me film inside. So that's how you do it, so to make it not very expensive. And I worked as a journalist, as you said in the introduction, and I traveled. I seen Timbuktu before and after the invasion. I went to Nigeria, Burkina Faso, so I've seen all of that. And the same thing also happened in 2016 when Donald Trump was elected. I was finishing my master's. And in New York, it was a shock, right? People always say, how did that happen? How the Brexit happened? How Salvini happened? And then we start thinking about it. And then we realize there were so many signs that we did decide to ignore. So this film is not about a city that is taken. This is like thinking of how a community could drift into extremism. I'm just using a religion here as a theme, but it could have been politics, it could have been drugs, it could have been something else. I just want to show how a family could be shaken because we live in a society where family is the most important thing. If I have something good or something bad, my family knows about it first. And with family, I mean large and extended family. Yeah.
Geht es ohne Übersetzung oder weil der Herr da hinten geht, können Sie sich, ja, okay, alles klar. Gut, weil das war jetzt auch zu viel jetzt, um das alles zu, okay. Yes, you said it's also about a lot of family issues in the country, in the village. Could you say a little bit more about this arranged marriage? Because this seems to me to be a very important point for the film. It starts with it, and all through the film, we always have these arranged marriages. So maybe you can say something about that too.
Yeah, I think my personal take on marriages is each one of them has some arrange on it. Because we always introduce our partner to our family and friends, and we still try to get the best out of it in some ways. And the funny thing about those so-called arranged marriages, they working more than the modern ones in some ways, mm-hmm. right? The families I had known that the marriages were just like a match between families. My brother was married this way. He's in his 22nd year. My other friend who maybe found a perfect match in Tinder, maybe just for a month, you know, you never know. So this thing was my central issue because I've seen my sisters and cousins being married this way. For the people who are from Senegal, we know we never announce a wedding a year before. It just doesn't make sense to us. When someone tells you, I'm getting married, it's always the next weekend, right? Or the next month, right? The Senegal is here. Do you agree or not? Yeah, I think it's rarely like I'm going to get married in 2022. They're going to say, what does it mean? Right? So the thing, this is something I wanted to show here and show how families sit down and ask for their, for those who are getting married, what do you think about it? And it's mostly two families, two communities. You don't marry just a single person. You're marrying among the community. People are trying to find a match that would not only work for you as an individual, but that would make the community as a stronger community and to move forward.
Are there already questions from the audience?
Mm-hmm. Would you yourself agree to an organized marriage, arranged marriage?
It depends with who.
But so the tradition has probably already changed, and now the younger generation.
Of course, it's changing a lot. I mean, younger, you have everything that is happening in Frankfurt, in Berlin. That's the same thing that happens in Dakar. It's a community also that's, I think, with the globalization, we all go through the same things. Traditions are still there, but people choose whoever they want to live with. Yeah.
Erstmal vielen Dank, merci vraiment, c'est un très bon film. Ich habe eine Frage, und zwar, Herr Dia kommt aus dem Senegal, ich komme aus Mali. Der islamische Terrorismus ist im ganzen Sahel, seit 2011, seit dem Fall Gaddafis, und dann Mali wurde fast überrannt und heute noch kämpft Mali. Vor drei Tagen sind Islamisten 100 Kilometer von Ségou entfernt vorgerückt. Meine Frage ist, wie gefährlich ist der Islamismus in Senegal? Bon, je peux... Très bien.
La question, oui, c'est
voilà. La question, c'est combien le danger islamiste règne aujourd'hui au Sénégal? Parce qu'au Mali... Et au Burkina, on n'a pas besoin de répéter ce qui se passe aujourd'hui. Il y a trois jours seulement, ils sont à 200 km de Ségou. Et Ségou, c'est la deuxième plus grande ville du Mali. Et donc, le Sénégal, qu'en est-il aujourd'hui? Ça, c'est le film, mais en réalité, quel est le danger islamiste au Sénégal aujourd'hui? Merci.
OK, thank you so much. So, as I said, this movie, because visiting Timbuktu, that was taken, as you said, in 2011, and seeing what was happening before and after. And in Timbuktu, people were always, there were some meetings happening late night. There were some people coming over. People are becoming veiled, like in the daily lives. There were those kind of signs. So for me, making this film as a Senegalese, somewhere where it didn't happen yet, it was, the interest is to tell to Senegalese people, if I can say that, that shouldn't wait to be hit to talk about it. Because Senegal is not safer than Mali. Senegal is not stronger than Mali. Senegalese people don't want peace more than Malians or Burkinabe, right? We all want to live in peaceful places. So this was the why. Because in reality, we had some people starting to preach, and some of them were kind of taken by the justice system, because it was seen, because Senegal is a laicity, is a laic country. So you cannot just be that strong in some, any, whatever religion you are in. So it didn't happen yet. So that is the why of the making the film, to get people talk about it, to get the debate started. Yeah.
En français.
Si. Ok, donc vous avez compris la question. Donc ma réponse est qu'au Sénégal, on n'a pas encore eu d'attaque terroriste et on remercie le ciel pour cela. Et que le film a été fait surtout pour amener le débat. Parce que les Sénégalais ne sont pas plus pacifiques que les Maliens et on n'aime pas la paix plus que les Maliens ou les Burkinabés. C'est aussi montrer qu'au Sénégal, des choses comme ça peuvent arriver dans tous les pays et dire aux Sénégalais quels sont les signes avant-coureurs, s'il y en a, parlons-en déjà présent.
In welchem Rahmen wird der Film auch im Senegal gezeigt, wenn das Ihr Ziel ist? Dans quel cadre vous allez montrer le film au Sénégal?
Yeah, that's I just watched your documentary before this. It was talking about trees from Sudan. Beautiful documentary. If you haven't watched it yet, check it out. And that's what we're gonna do, because distribution is the weakest link in the Senegalese film industry, because now it's coming back. We have more Senegalese movies in Locarno, in Cannes, in Berlin. And only in Dakar now we have a couple of theaters who opened. So what we're gonna do, my friend and I, who is my business partner, we bought a projector and a screen, and we're gonna tour about Senegal. And the national premiere is gonna be actually in this small town you've seen here, and it's gonna be in February 21st, in 2 weeks. So that's the only way we can share the film with people. We won't make any money with it, but at least we're gonna party and have a debate after. Yeah.
I still wanted to ask about the title. You called the film Bamum Nafi, Nafi's father. So why did you choose to, not to name him as a person, but to have him as the father of Nafi? And
I think this comes, at film school I had a lot of problems. One of them being writing teachers telling you to have one protagonist, one person. I just couldn't. I think one of the reasons is I just grew up in a family. I didn't have my, not in a bad way, but I didn't have my own room. I would share my shirts with my brothers and cousins. So life has always been with at least two people or more. So this movie is about mostly the paternal love, how a father could love his daughter, how a daughter could love his father. So I couldn't decide whose movie it was, because the both of them are very important to me. They are both very dear to this film. They could both be their principal characters in this movie. So, and also I didn't want it to be Nafi only. I didn't want it to be Cherno only. So I wanted to show how that connection is there. This is a daughter of someone called Cherno, and this is Nafi's father. That's how the title came. Yeah.
So my question is, you said, you explained that when you had been in the States, people always ask you about your religion, or you said you felt like justifying being, talking about Islam. So what is your, how would you define, because in your film, it was talking about the terrorists, you know. It was the people who are called terrorists. So how do you distinguish between terrorists, jihadists, and Islamists?
Wow, that's a tough question. I think that's already part of the justification. For instance, I understand that your question comes from a very good intention, right? But this is a hurting question. In some ways, because if you ask a Muslim to divide that, it's not fair in some ways, right? So, but I understand the question. So the thing is, jihadist and Islamist have nothing to do with just their beliefs, right? You have you could call the people doing mass shootings in the U.S. You have in the U.S. you have people killed more with mass shooting more than any other act of terrorist, and in the U.S. they refuse to call them terrorists. It's always people who have some mental health. It's like domestic violence, but it's never a terrorist attack. If that person happened to have any link with Islam, then he becomes a terrorist. Right. So this is the main problem that people face all the time. And it's not right to put to all the Muslims in the world, I think we are a billion, putting them on that, because there is not just one type of Muslim. It's like a whole range. Those who eat pork and who drink, in Senegal we call them les musulmans de gauche, right? The Muslims of the left, right? You have those and you have many other people. And that one person that is just going around killing people, and the reality is those so-called jihadists, they kill more Muslims than any other religion. Right. Yeah. Thank you. And that's an issue that people don't talk about. and like countries that are examples of cohabitation, like Lebanon or Senegal, people don't talk about those because they're not interested in that. So it's very important for us to be all aware of this, to be aware that the biggest part of it, I'm sure you're walking by Muslims every single day in Frankfurt, if you live in Frankfurt, and you don't even realize.
What is the sad film Parent and Child rewatched on television? What is the film the father and the daughter rewatched again for the last time on the television screen in front of the shop?
That's a very good question. There is a movie I wanted, but I didn't get the rights. So I have to become very creative. So I actually used a short film of one of my friends. That was the only way I could get around that. Yeah.
Which one you wanted? Which
one? I wanted two movies. One is from Senegal. It's called Tukibuki. Mm-hmm. And the other one I wanted was an Italian neorealistic movie. And I couldn't get both of them. I mean, maybe I didn't try enough. Yeah. They understood it all, so.
I'm thinking about this person of Tieno, mm-hmm. For me, he's not ambivalent, but he's very. On the one hand, he seems weak, also due to his illness, but on the one hand, he's also very strong. But
I think this is something I wanted difficult. Since the writing, mm-hmm. the illness of Cherno, I think mm-hmm. that's our illness of all of us who think we are open-minded, we are progressist. We have this kind of illness that we don't do much, mm-hmm. right? We sit in cafes, we talk about democracy, we talk about what's happening in England, we talk about what's happening in Syria, but what do? We do nothing. Mm-hmm. We kind of like sick like Cherno, mm-hmm. like our bodies or our brains are blocked that we couldn't move a finger to try anything. How many of us go to protest, for instance? You know, how many of us like try something? Maybe the best thing we do is post on Facebook. That's the furthest we could go to have a say in this world. So Cherno is that type of person. Mm-hmm. The only person who is fighting for the good of kind of the good of all of us is there. And Cherno is not perfect. He is an open-minded imam, but he didn't want his daughter to go to college. He's not that at that level. So it was a choice that I made since the writing of the project. Yeah.
But finally, he's the one who finds the solution to drive them out.
Yes. Yes, he's the one who found the solution. And the solution didn't come from Islam. That rapt is something Islam is completely against, right? Because for me, the solutions in this world is not in religion, at least not in a religion as institution. Spirituality is good. I believe that there is a higher being somewhere, it could be. But still, our solutions is not, because religions, I think, like borders, they draw borders, mm-hmm. right? You don't believe on what I do, then we have a problem, which is not true, right? And the river you see here in this film is actually the actual border between Senegal and Mauritania. If I want to cross that border, I need a stamp. And it's maybe smaller than the river just behind the theater here, which is very interesting. So we're just talking about those borders that we create. And this is something just some old people draw at a conference saying this is the border between Senegal and Mauritania. And we take it so seriously and then we hurt ourselves for no reason. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It may be hard to describe one's own visual language, but how would you try to describe your own visual way of expressing what you want to say, what you want to show?
You mean in the
this
movie?
This is an aesthetic question.
Ah, okay. I think the first thing is that I am a camera person. I do a lot of camera, actually. That's what I do for a living. So in some ways, in this visual film, it was very clear since the beginning that we just didn't want to have beautiful shots. Right. And I understand that people in some movies, you have those shots like where birds are flying and it's beautiful. But we didn't want to get those because I knew it for two reasons. I'm from a continent that is beautiful, where people are really, really beautiful. And we dress very well. The colors and everything else is just there. You don't need much. So just follow the story and the beauty is going to come up. That was the only plan I did with the DP. Yeah.
Still, the images are very beautiful, but images, in another sense,
because of course,
they're very nice and well.
Yeah, the clothes, so the colors, mm-hmm. the river, everything is just there. You have just to come and grab it in some ways. And the more you follow the story, the more that beauty comes out. Yeah. Thank you.
So maybe what is your next project? We already have.
Thanks.
If you have a next project, already working on the next project.
Yeah, I'm trying because this one was very painful. Self-production, never again. Oh. And also what I can say, if you see someone trying to make a movie because there is no longer a producer or just a rich guy who gives $1 million, that doesn't exist anymore. So if you see a young or lesser young person trying to raise money, I don't know, crowdfunding, if you have 20 euros, give it to him. If a neighbor wants to use your garage or your car, let them use it. That's the only way we make these movies, because the community was behind it. So we all can be producers today by just helping a little. Or at least if they're blocking your street for a scene, let them do it, don't call the police, right? Thank you so much. Okay.